And I'll never forget Cheryl Underwood and Ty Trebek were on stage. Wow. And Cheryl Underwood pulled out the envelope and she said, you're going to have to say this one because I almost said cracker spot.
Oh, well, no.
When, total opposite. When she said it, I knew instantly that was us. So,
you were like, I won. I didn't want to win like that, but yeah, I won.
I'll be cracker spot. Just give us that award. You know.
You're going to hear Keisha with a little bit of tequila in her system. I usually have a little bit of wine. Tequila is a whole different level. So here we go. I am here with Sherita, owner of Croaker Spot. The first thing that my sister said when I told her that I was interviewing the owner of Croaker Spot was, are we going to have a fish boat? And I said, so Croaker Spot is heavily known in Richmond for their fish boats, for their seafood, for their southern food. And I just know that if you're a Richmond listener, especially from Richmond, you've heard of Croaker Spot. So Sherita, welcome. And how would you describe Croaker Spot?
First, let me say congratulations on 50.
Oh, thank
you. That's a big number. And you should celebrate that.
Yeah.
You know, because it doesn't happen for everyone.
Right.
You know, and as we get into all of this, you'll understand where I'm coming from.
Yeah.
You know, but as far as Croaker Spot, you would actually be surprised how many people that actually live in the city that don't know about Croaker Spot.
What?
Yeah, we get it a lot. You know, now the locals that have been here since we started back on 2nd Street, now those that know about it.
Yeah, know where you started.
We started at 2nd and Lee. It was a 39-seater. Yeah, we had 39 seats, and that included the outside patio.
Okay.
And
absolutely. And, I mean, people waited 2 and 3 hours to get inside.
Wow.
You know,
yeah.
So what I would say about Croaker Spot is it's legendary.
Legendary. You know, I love that
legendary
word.
Yeah. It's fulfilling.
Yeah.
It's family-oriented.
Yeah.
And it's phenomenal.
Yeah, that's... Well, look, I think you might be describing yourself because, well, because honestly, like, I was so excited to interview you, but mostly because of when I heard this one sentence, you started as a part-time hostess and you are now the owner. Y'all, that don't happen every day. Can we acknowledge that? There's a story behind that and I want you to tell it. Like, how was that the goal?
Not at all. Mm-hmm. My goal was never to work in a restaurant. It was actually my first experience ever in a restaurant, you know, but I have 2 kids. I was a single parent and my son was about to graduate high school and he was going off to the University of Charleston in West Virginia.
Okay.
And I was like, you know what? I need to get some extra income because I don't know what this is going to entail. He didn't stay. He didn't like it. So he came on back home. But that's what drove me to go to Croaker Spot. And I actually lived around the corner on Clay Street. And so my kids and I loved Croaker Spot. I mean, you know, at the time, single parent, you know, that was a treat for us.
Right, yeah.
So we happened to walk there for dinner one night, my son and my daughter and myself, and my daughter is just a different person and she's always looking to thrive and she's like, Mom, they have a now hiring sign. Maybe you should apply here.
So your daughter pointed it out.
Yeah,
wow.
She said, maybe you should apply here. She said, they hire hostess, cashiers, you can do that. And so I did. I applied and 3 days later I was called back.
Wow.
And then I got the job as a part-time host. I was working in insurance at the time, so I had a full-time job and this is my part-time.
So you were adding on to your responsibilities.
Yes.
Wow.
Yes, taking care of 2 kids. Had to do it. And so I was there for approximately 4 months, and I was asked to be a manager.
Okay.
But the most amazing part was my first day, I cried and went home.
Because you hated it?
I was kind of thrown in because it was busy. Croaker Spot's always busy.
Right, right, right.
And the way the system was set up, you had to push a takeout button.
Okay.
You had to push the word takeout. And so I was a cashier and host. I kept forgetting to hit takeout.
Oh, no.
So when you don't hit takeout, they plate the food for people dining in.
Oh, no.
So several times they had to remake the food because I forgot to push takeout.
Yeah.
And finally, one of the cooks, he had told me 3 times. And that fourth time, he just went off and started flaring his hands. I was like, I can't do it. I can't do it. I can't do it.
Is he still there?
He was from Barbados and he went back home,
okay.
But they eventually fell in love with me.
I mean, they fell in love with you.
So, I mean, that day, it was just like so overwhelming because the crowd was there. I mean, it was just busy.
Yeah.
And I kept messing up. And so,
I've never worked in a restaurant, but I've always can tell, like, when you see new waiters, you can tell that they're going through it,
mm-hmm.
you know?
And I had never been in one either. And that one little button sent me home crying. And Anjali Moon, she's a great inspiration to me. She's the one that hired me. She was the general manager at the time. Okay. And she caught me outside. She was like, it's okay. You can go home, but are you coming back? I was like, I don't know. She's like, just come back tomorrow.
Yeah.
And so after that day, I was like, you know what? I can do this. You know, and so, and I did. I mastered it. In 4 months, she asked me to be a manager. 2 years later, I became general manager.
Wow.
I actually moved into her position.
Wow.
Anjali, she's amazing. Anjali,
that name
Africana
is familiar
Independent
to me.
Film Festival. Yes. That's her company.
I'm like, she's familiar to me. She's an RVA name.
That is who hired me.
Yeah.
And I mean, wow. It's because of her that I was given the opportunity.
Yeah.
And so once I moved into her position as general manager, I was side by side with the owner, Neverd Eggleston. Inspiration, I mean, amazing man. And
is he from the family that originally owned it?
Gotcha. Eggleston.
Okay.
They have a 100-year legacy in the city of Richmond.
Yeah.
Back to the Hotel Eggleston that was on 2nd Street.
Wow.
Back in the 1930s and 1950s.
RVA staple, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it's actually in the Green Book. So if
in the Green Book?
Yes, the hotel's in the Green Book.
Wow.
And so he was my boss. And so I ended up working side by side with him for so many years. Now, I've been there 18 years.
Okay.
Okay. But 5 years ago, after we had built Petersburg, because I was actually an intricate part of establishing the new restaurant in Petersburg. So I've been a part of everything that we've grown since then. And we were just riding down the street one day. He said, Rita, I think you should take Petersburg. I said, and do what?
What you talking about?
Yeah. He said, I think you should take Petersburg and it'd be yours. You do Petersburg. So, I said, do what with it? Never before. Do what with Petersburg? He said, Rita, you can do this. You deserve it. And I was like, I don't know about that. He said, no, you can do it. So we did, you know, what we need to do to get that settled. But it wasn't but a year and a half later. He's like, Rita, you should take Richmond, too.
Whoa.
I mean, I'm like, no, I don't
to
want
to be this. Honest, do you think, like, was he tired?
No, because he's still in restaurant.
Oh, my goodness. So he saw, yeah. He truly saw something in you. Whoa.
Yeah, I mean, I was literally his right hand. And even before he turned that over and offered that to me, no matter where you went, people thought I was the owner.
They already thought you.
Absolutely.
Because let me tell you the truth. I did my research, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, let me see, you know, she's the owner. Like, you pop up. You're the one that's on the news. You're the one everyone refers to as the owner. You're doing the work. And that's been for not just recently. This is for years.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
In 2011, we won the Steve Harvey Hoodie Award for Best Soul
Food. Let's talk about that. Steve Harvey. So I hear Steve Harvey is a huge fan of the Croaker spot.
Absolutely.
As he should
Absolutely.
Be. Yeah. So what's that experience being like? Like a real celebrity acknowledging how great this restaurant is?
Well, I think that's when Never saw my real potential because that's when I became general manager, and he said, you know what I want, Rita? I want that hoodie award. I had never heard of it.
The hoodie award, okay.
Mm-hmm. He said, I want that hoodie award. I'm like, what's that? He said, you know that thing Steve Harvey does where you go in, the best soul food, best car wash, best nail salon. He said, I want that. I said, okay, we'll get it. And I actually pushed for it, and I did my research to see how you can get it. And actually, it was up to our customers. So it's people like you that actually got that for us because you don't get to go out and do what you do as a business to get it. Your customers, your clients have to vote you in for that.
So that means you guys actually worked for it and that the customers felt that and really, you know, said this restaurant is worthy of nominating.
Absolutely. And
wow.
So once you receive the nomination, there's four people in your category. And it's really like the Grammys. You don't know until they call your name.
Mm-hmm.
So they flew us into Las Vegas because we did get nominated. And we were sitting in this row together with three other restaurants, one from Chicago and Atlanta, Georgia, and D.C.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll never forget, Sheryl Underwood and Ty Trebek were on stage.
Wow.
And Sheryl Underwood pulled out the envelope, and she said, you're going to have to say this one because I almost said Croaker spot.
Oh, well, no. Total opposite.
When she said it, I knew instantly that was us. So,
you were like, I won. I didn't want to win like that, but I won.
I'll be Croaker spot. Just give us that award. You know, and so I actually went on stage with Deborah to receive the award.
Nice.
And he had already said, Rita, you got your speech ready? You got your speech ready? I was
you
like,
gave a
no.
Speech?
No, I wasn't going to give a speech.
Said I ain't going
to
do that.
But he told me to. And as we were walking up the stairs, and if you watch the video, you can pull it up on YouTube, the 2011 Hoodie Award Best Soul Food winner. If you'll see me turn around to him and I go, you got a speech, right? But I think that's when he saw my drive.
Right.
You know, and that if you give me a task, I'm going to accomplish it.
Yeah.
You know, so, and I think that that's what gave him the belief in me to say, when I want to turn my family's legacy over to someone,
this is going to be the woman I'm going to do it to.
Absolutely.
That's beautiful. Mm-hmm. You know, I got the chills. I love it. I love it. All right, let's get into the juicy stuff. Mm-hmm. What was the most challenging thing about transitioning from general manager, which is still high up, but now to owner, like I'm running the show?
Well, the most challenging thing for me is I have to do it now. Yeah. You know, when there's someone else over you, an owner, I can say, hey, the hot water heater just went out. You need to call somebody.
Right.
But now it's my staff saying, guess what? The hot water heater just went out. You need to call somebody.
That's
the most challenging part. But other than that, I'm actually still doing what I've been doing all along.
Really?
You know, so, and I think that that's why he would never be the one to go out and talk to the media or, you know,
so anything. So you were doing a lot of the owner type of responsibilities even before.
Yes.
Gotcha.
And even back to Steve Harvey, when he did his last comedy show with a couple of other entertainers, it was called The Landmark then. Uh-huh. I had to have a pan of cornbread baked to take to him, to take back to Atlanta.
Wow. Oh, so Steve said, I ain't leaving Richmond without some cornbread from Croaker's spot.
Yeah, we have pictures from the Landmark where we actually delivered a pan of cornbread to him.
I love that. Mm-hmm. So what skills, though, have you had to learn, though, throughout, you know, now that you're the owner, and you're, I know you were doing a lot of responsibilities beforehand, but I'm sure you still had to kind of learn how to do certain things that probably weren't in your toolhouse beforehand.
Well, I had to learn to embrace the good and the bad, you know, because there are times that I didn't have to deal with it. I could just turn away from it. Mm-hmm. But being an owner now, I don't put all of that responsibility on my team, you know, because in any industry, you're going to have people that are satisfied and people that are not.
Absolutely.
And unfortunately, in the food and hospitality industry, you run into more people that are really satisfied, but want to say that they're not.
Oh, no.
For whatever
they can get. Oh, you mean they ate that food, but they still got something to say.
To get whatever they can out of it. So, you know, I had to learn to be able to find the correct way to get past the philosophy that the customer is always right. Because I'm going to tell y'all right now, no, they're not. You know, they're not. They're not always right. But a goal as an entrepreneur or a manager or anything, you make them feel like
they
were
right. Yeah.
But 99% of the time, they were not right. You know, so, you know, I've never believed in that. And that's one of the questions that I ask in interviews when I'm interviewing people. How do you feel about that philosophy? Mm. And when they come back with, they're not always right, but I make them feel like it, they get the job.
Yeah.
You know, because they understand what we're going through. So the hardest part is drawing that line and training the people that have that responsibility to feel that same way, but to make it right.
Right, yeah. What I love about your business model, too, is that you are a second-chance employer. So you give opportunities to people who have a past. Tell me about that business decision to be a second-chance employer, and what's that experience been like?
Well, it started with Neverett.
Okay.
You know, he's that person that if you're walking down the street and And you walk up and say, man, can you help me out? Yeah, I can help you out. Go ahead and clean up that back area for you, you know, and I'll compensate you. But he always said, Rita, people have past, you know, and you want to be that person that says, hey, you know what? I'm going to give you a chance.
Right.
You know, you let me down, that's on you, but I'm going to give you a chance. And I can honestly say that we've given multiple chances to people, and some people that have had scarred past or, you know, they went places that other people wouldn't hire them because they had records or things like that. They've been some of our best employees.
Really?
Mm-hmm. And if you talk to anyone that works for us, some of those that have been gone for whatever reason, they come back, you know, and we even hire them back even after we fired them, you know.
Right, yeah.
We're going to give you another chance. Come on, we'll try it again.
Yeah, I actually listened to another interview you did, and just from the reputation of Croaker Spot is that people who work there feel like a family culture environment. They actually enjoy coming to work and enjoy the culture you've created there. So will you just, what are some tips, because I do have some business owners who are in the audience, also have business owners that listen, on getting quality employees that want to stay, because you need some longevity, but also creating an environment, a culture that makes them want to stay. Like, what are any tips or guidance on that?
You know, most of the time people think it's monetary, but it's not. You know, of course, everyone wants money. Mm-hmm. But when you get to know their personalities, you have to treat each individual as they are.
Yeah.
You can have rules for guidance, you know, and for structure. But you have to know that employee that you can go to and say, hey, I need you to come in tomorrow and pull a double. And they'd be like, okay, I got it. And you also have to know the one that you say, can you please come in for me tomorrow? I mean, I am really struggling here. I need you to work this double. You know,
we'll look out okay, for so you. You know how to talk to people.
Absolutely.
You know how to understand people, how they will receive. Is that a skill you learned or is that something natural for you?
I think it's natural for me, but okay. It works.
You're a people person then, yeah.
Yeah, but you do. You have to treat individuals as they are. And where people make mistakes is because you have a rule and it's supposed to apply to everyone. Mm-hmm. It can. It's just how you deliver that rule.
Yeah.
You have to know how you can interpret that to someone so right. They will receive it the way it's supposed to be received.
Yeah. How is building relationships? I'm a stickler on, I think relationships are what help you the most in business. Have you found that to be true? How is building relationships?
That's my success.
Exactly, right?
You know, we're an independent black-owned company. Mm-hmm. We don't have a corporate pool of money sitting there to take care of things. I was closed for 8 months.
Oh, yeah.
So we'll relationships are what keep you going, you know, mm-hmm. and that it works because you have to be able to, your credibility is everything. Mm-hmm. If you say you're going to do something, then just do it.
Yeah.
And if you can't do it, you have to communicate. And that's how you build good relationships.
Yes.
You know, you have to communicate. And if you always do like you said or let them know that you can't, then that builds trust.
Mm-hmm.
And if a person can trust you in a relationship, it's going to be successful.
Beautiful. That I wholeheartedly agree with you on that. For sure. So you mentioned you were closed for 8 months. Let's get into the fire.
Girl.
So if you don't know, there's two locations, correct?
Yes.
Of Croaker Spot. Well, one location is in Hall Street here in Richmond, right down the street. And then we have a second location in Petersburg. And we'll get into the new building. Come on, girl. Like, that's huge. Okay. So, but the location in Richmond about 8 months ago had a fire that kept it closed for 8 months. What was that like?
Horrible.
I know.
The fire wasn't bad at all. And I'll give a shout out to Richmond Police Fire Department. They were there in 3 minutes.
Wow.
I was across the street in my office, and one of my managers ran in, and she's like, I've been calling your phone. The building's on fire. I'm like, oh.
Did you think it was a joke? I'm sorry. I'm not trying to make light of it. But you had to have kind of thought it was a joke, right?
A little bit?
No, no.
All okay. I said was, what do you mean?
Like, what do you mean it's on fire?
I went out, and actually, it was strictly in the hood.
In the hood. A hood of the stove.
That goes up. Mm-hmm. That goes okay. up straight. It was contained in the hood. It started from my salamander and went up in the hood. But unfortunately, there's apartments above. You know, I rent my commercial space.
Oh, okay.
So it doesn't belong to me. I rent the commercial space.
Multiple sources of income, people. I'm not going to gloss over that.
No. I rent from someone.
Oh, I got you. Okay.
Well, it went up through the hood into the apartments, but it was contained there. But the fire department was there in like 3 minutes. They put the fire out, but of course, they do a lot of damage when they're trying to figure out where the fire is going. Ah. You know, so, and then it came to the point of, and it's still under investigation. We don't know what caused it.
Okay.
But it was to the point that there had to be a lot of inspections and permits. And
so that's why it was closed. It's not because the actual building.
No.
Wow. No. So it's Richmond City's progress, or I guess public health concerns, right, to make sure it's safe to be open back.
And it's the whole process when you have a landlord involved because they're apartments, and okay. then there's the fire suppression system, and then there's the hood cleaner. So mm-hmm. there was a lot of aspects of it to determine how it was actually caused.
Okay.
So that's a part of it. So when they had to determine that, that meant taking out my salamander, taking out my stove, taking out my fire suppression.
So everything had to be removed,
which means I had to replace.
Right.
And then with COVID and everything else, delivery times, you know, I might have normally gotten the stove replaced in 6 weeks. It took 6 weeks or longer. So the process of then getting on everyone's schedule for the city to come out and do their inspections, I mean, it was just time consuming because with the way things are now in the midst of a pandemic, the timing of everything.
Right.
So that's why we were closed for 8 months.
Right.
But as soon as we could get back open, we did.
So when did you guys open up again?
We opened takeout not this, on the 5th of November, and it was takeout only, but it was doing so well, and we had about 70% of our staff come back. So wow, we were staffed enough to open the inside.
Wow, I thought it was just takeout. So no, now the inside is open.
So last Friday we did a grand reopening.
Can we cheers to that? They are open again here in Richmond. Yes, that's incredible. Yes. So. And meanwhile, while you're going through all that, which is incredibly, I'm sure, difficult navigating, trying to get back open, you had moved the Petersburg location to a new building. It's an iconic building in Old Town Petersburg, and it's 10,000 square foot. It is, I mean, it's an iconic building in Old Town Petersburg, guys. Yeah, 10,000 square foot. That was a huge business move. What inspired that?
Prayer. We were on the corner in another building where I rented the commercial space on River Street. And the Farmers Market building, it's an octagon-shaped building. Yeah. It's two floors. I watched it for years. Mm-hmm. And I watched restaurants go in. They didn't last a year. Another one went in, did last a little over a year. And I was like, I really like that building.
It's very iconic. Like, you see it and you don't forget it. You know, right. It stands in your memory.
But it was designed by the city of Petersburg. And the actual building belongs to the city of Petersburg.
Okay.
But I just kept looking at it and thinking about it and talking about it. And one day I mentioned it to my attorney. Mm. And he was like, well, I know who has the lease in there. Do you want to talk to him? I was like, maybe. I'm not sure. And so we went through all the legalities, and I talked to him. And there's actually a 40-year lease on the building.
A 40-year lease?
Yes.
Wow.
And so after having the meetings in the middle of a pandemic, December 28th.
I never heard such a thing. Sorry. Sorry. Okay. Yeah.
So you basically own it. Yeah, where are you going?
That's your building, girl. So, you're going to be there. Your kids going to be there.
I bought his lease.
So wow. We were able congratulations.
To move in December 28th of last year in the middle of the pandemic. Mm-hmm. And now, yes, I own the Petersburg facility as well.
That's huge. Of course, I'm all RVA all day, but go out to Petersburg and check out this spot. It's beautiful. There's a new business in town.
Golden Touch Mobile Detailing.
If you're in the Richmond, Virginia area and tired of riding dirty,
or you appreciate a deep clean,
book an appointment with Golden Touch Mobile Detailing. It's not your average car wash. Full interior and exterior cleaning, and Golden Touch Mobile Detailing comes to you.
It's the attention to detail to make you a returning customer.
Follow the Instagram at Golden Touch RVA and book your appointment.
I guarantee you'll be riding clean.
So you have this new, beautiful, huge location, iconic building. What made you not give up on the Richmond location of Croaker Spot?
Well, the thing about Richmond is I would never go out of Richmond because that's where the Eggleston's legacy is.
Yeah.
And my goal is to carry on that legacy because they entrusted me with that.
Yeah.
And even though my boss is the grandson of the original Eggleston, mm-hmm. I have to embrace that because without that, I wouldn't be where I am.
Ooh. Yeah. That's beautiful. Can you tell them to listen to the podcast, please?
I will. Oh, if y'all want to find him, he's over at Sugar's Crab Shack. It's the same man.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, Sugar's Crab Shack. That is him.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Wow.
And I run that one too.
let me throw that in there. All right, what's one thing that's working really well in the business, right? But what's one thing you're working to improve upon, too?
Well, the one thing that's working really well is repeat customers, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah.
Longevity and the ability to maintain. We're 20 years strong.
Ooh, 20 years.
April 9th was 20 years for Croaker Spot. Ooh. The one thing that I'm trying to work on is being more efficient and maybe faster service. Mm-hmm. But what everyone needs to understand is I don't have a microwave in a building.
Oh, no microwave. Yes, no microwave. A restaurant with no microwave.
None. So everything that we fix is cooked fresh.
Right.
Which means it's time consuming.
Right.
You know, so I either want to find a way to be able to produce it faster, but I will never commercialize it. Never.
Okay.
You know, because we stand on that. So we need to find a way to produce it faster or a better way to communicate to our guests the understanding that if you want it fresh and you want it right, it may take a little while. If you can sit in a drive-thru and wait on Captain D's, you can sure, and they have a sign posted, everything is cooked to order. You can definitely wait for home-cooked fresh food that we're cooking every day.
Absolutely.
You know, nothing's pre-made. We do our own crab stuffed flounder. Mm-hmm. We stuff the crab in ourselves. Mm-hmm. You know, so I want to get out there that people need to understand I'm not commercialized at all.
Yeah.
You know, I have real chefs. I have real cooks. Mm-hmm. I have real recipes that they have to follow.
Yeah.
You know, I don't order anything that's pre-made or prepared for us.
Right.
So,
you know. Say this. Yeah. I'm sorry. When my sister said that she had Croaker spot, I said, what? Croaker spot?
What is happening right now? It's always your family, right? We are Kroger.
Mercedes.
I'm sorry, y'all ain't got fish, okay?
Thank you.
Right.
Thank you.
The people love you. The people love you.
Thank you. Well, I'm telling you, it wasn't mine. I just got to carry it on. It's mine now.
But
I'm carrying it on.
Doing an amazing
job.
Thank you.
And thank you.
Yeah.
Doing an amazing job. That's all I'm trying to say.
Thank you.
I can tell no difference, but I just know that, like, came from family. And girl, you are family.
I told him I'm going to hyphenate my name, Megan Eggleston, just so I stop answering so many questions.
Thank you, sister. Thank you so much. Thank you for your input. Sherita, where do you get your business guidance? Like, when you come to make business decisions, where do you get that guidance from?
Neverett Eggleston.
Oh, straight from the legendary owner.
Absolutely. He's amazing.
Yeah.
He really is. This man can take a beverage napkin and draw a design on it, and I promise you, it'll be a $1 million venue. Oh, wow. He's amazing.
Yeah.
He really
is. I love that you still have such a great connection with him.
Trust me. Call Rita. I told him I'll put it on his tombstone if he goes before me, because his answer to everything is, call Rita. She'll take care of it. Call Rita.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I love that, though, because that means, I mean, honestly, to leave your family's legacy to someone, I mean, let's be honest, outside of the family, that's a huge thing to do. He mm-hmm. saw something in you. Like, so what would you say is it about you that gives you the qualification to continue on this legacy?
Loyalty.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Loyalty. He never had to worry about anything with me. Never. Yeah. Always been loyal to the business. I've never tried to take advantage of what he's offered me. He knew he could trust me with everything he had going on. Mm-hmm. You know, and I'm the one that even the vendors call instead of the business owner at the time, you know.
Yeah.
We're like, call Rita.
Yeah.
You know, so, and he knew that no matter what it was, I was going to take care of it, mm-hmm. no matter what it took.
I asked this question because we've spoke previously. How has faith played into your entrepreneur journey?
I can honestly say that it wasn't my plan. Mm. So it had to be someone else's.
Yeah.
You know, I went in for a part-time job. Mm-hmm. Never worked in a restaurant before. And now I own two.
Oof, child.
So there had to be a higher power that said, you know what? I've got you.
Yeah.
And I've always believed that your plan is laid before you're even born. Mm-hmm. You know, you can do whatever you choose to do, but you're going to be guided mm-hmm. to what the plan is for you.
And how has your life changed from starting 18 years ago mm-hmm. as a single mother of two to now an owner of two restaurants?
I'm trying to get my daughter to move back from Vegas and come and help me.
You need some help. You need a different type of help now.
It's not happening, but my son, both of my kids work there. Yeah. And my son decided to step out and do his own. He got married and started his own family and everything. So he got out of the restaurant industry. And my daughter worked there when she was a kid going to college. And then she moved to Vegas. So it's like, y'all left me by myself.
Yeah.
You know, but I think that... even with my staff, they've become my family.
Yeah.
And I do have family that works there for me from time to time. That Brittany over there mm-hmm. and her mom's a bartender for me sometimes. Mm-hmm. So even with bringing in my family, I still treat my staff as family. They're not workers to me. That's mm-hmm. my family. I mean, we're all family. And I think that just believing in the fact that I'm doing what was set for me, mm-hmm. I'm going to prosper.
Oh, beautiful. Absolutely. Absolutely. So we will close out on this. What do you feel like from your experience is some entrepreneur tips to our listeners that you want to give for success in business?
Embrace your challenges. Mm-hmm. Face them. Accept your failures. Mm-hmm. Embrace your successes. And just seek guidance from people that have done it before you. Mm-hmm. You know, yes. Seek that guidance. It's always like in that those girlfriends. If they're in a bad relationship, don't take their advice. You know? But if they've been successful in what they're doing, then at least hear them, yeah. You know? And then you can choose your own path. Because, again, it's already set for you. You just have to learn the way to follow it.
Mm-hmm. I love that. Actually, I want to close out on one more thing. What do you feel like you've learned the most about yourself as you've seen your life unfold over the last 18 years?
I've learned that I did not realize how my personality could take me to where I am. Because that's what it all came from.
Oh, who you are led you to where you were meant to be.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Well, you guys know we love to close out on a game. So, you ready for Would You Rather This or That? Let's do it.
I'm doing that?
Yeah. It's going to be you. Well, how I like to do it is I'm going to ask you, and then I'm going to allow the audience to also scream out their preference. Mm-hmm. Okay? So a little interactive. Okay. You ready, babe? Would you rather this or that? Would you rather be known for your talent or your personality?
Well, I just answered that. Yeah. My personality.
Personality. All right, audience.
Personality.
Okay. This or that? Coke or Pepsi?
Pepsi.
Coke. Would you rather? Audience. Would you rather be embarrassed in front of your friends or be embarrassed in front of strangers?
Strangers.
I don't want my friends remembering that shit. Like, they don't even remember.
If they're your friends, they're real.
Girl, they'll bring that shit up forever.
And that's fine, because they're real ones.
That's right.
Now, let me just say, this or that actually means a lot to me. Apple or Android?
Android.
Apple all day, every day for life. When I get a text message from someone and I just got their phone number and I don't see the dots come up when they're typing, I'm like, no. A part of me dies a little bit every time. This has been a very major decision in our friendship for a long time, bitch. Alright, would you rather owe money or owe a favor?
Owe money.
My time is worth so much more.
Owe money. Because that favor could be.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Exactly, yeah. Alright, y'all. Last one. This or that, Lorena and Mercedes. Never again, y'all two. Okay. This or that. Teamwork makes the dream work, or if you want it done right, do it yourself.
Nope. Teamwork.
Teamwork makes the dream work. Because this live show would not have happened if it wasn't for the people who joined in to make this come together for us. So teamwork makes the dream work, okay?
Absolutely.
All right, guys. Sherita, you want to tell the audience how they can connect with Croaker Spot, where they can reach you? You're like all street in Petersburg.
All these things come I just see said, it. I'll just draw a blank. Now, you can definitely find us at 1020 Hall Street, Richmond, Virginia, or 9 East Old Street in Petersburg. If you have concerns, email me, smcgowan@croakerspot.com. We have Facebook and Twitter, I think. I know we have Facebook. Mm-hmm. I don't answer it all the time, but I answer it as soon as I can. And it's Croaker Spot Restaurants.
Beautiful. Sherita, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
Yo, I just want to let y'all know that Sherita didn't even know this was going to be. I thought she knew. I told her. But she didn't realize this was going to be a live show. So when she got here, she's like, she said, wait, people are going to be here seeing me do this?
I went home and changed my clothes because I had on work clothes. I was like, I'm going to get comfortable.
Yeah, comfortable clothes. She thought we were going to be all cozy doing a podcast recording. But she had a beautiful audience.
Yes. Thank you.
Indeed. Thanks for listening to the Ground Up Podcast. If you like what you hear, hit that subscribe button, rate, and leave a review. You can find us on Instagram at the Ground Up Podcast. Don't forget to subscribe to the YouTube channel. And if you're really feeling us, become a Patreon, or as we like to call them, a friend of the podcast.